That's way over in May. Okay. Well, it's good to see your beautiful faces today. And you're supposed to say, he's talking about me. Some people had no problem knowing, you just going, yeah. It's a big deal, yeah. If you have your Bibles, turn with me to 1 Samuel chapter 30. And I think that I want to encourage you today because God is going to bring restoration. Oh, by the way, I forgot to, my wonderful daughter is home with us this week, and so we're very happy to have her with us, my daughter Bethany. And she's my oldest of four daughters, and she's been in California, and she's going back there, unfortunately. Yeah, she's made her home in Redding, California. Have you ever been out there? It's very, very beautiful out there. Yeah, I could see why the early, when they cross the country in covered wagons, after you get through the deserts of Wyoming, the southern Wyoming and Nevada and all that, and once you hit the California border, Oregon border, it's just the topography changes so drastically. It's absolutely beautiful. You can see why they, after they'd gone through there, that they really thought this was paradise. It's just so beautiful. Thank you, Kevin. Well, I want to encourage you about restoration. What do I mean by restoration? Some people have feel like things they've lost out, and will they ever get them back? And life has hit them broadside with some things that they didn't expect. And what does God have for me now? You know, what are the new things that God has for us? And I think it's very exciting to think of restoration. Because life hits us with unexpected things that we don't ever, you know, we didn't know where that was coming from. That wasn't in the 10-year plan, right? And then we have to pick up the pieces and go forward and seek the Lord and find out what His will, what His great will is, what the good things are that God has for us. And I'll tell you, He has good things.
Yeah.
He has great things ahead. All things work together for good. I know that. Unfortunately, we quote that verse so much that it's become like a cliche and it becomes void of power. But truly, all things work for you. All things are working for your good. Everything, even the bad things, God can turn it around and make it into something amazing. And it's important that we maintain our hope, maintain our faith, maintain a positive outlook, maintain our trust in the Lord, and don't allow bitterness over loss and different things to get a hold of you, because God has good things ahead. You believe that?
Yeah.
Believe that today. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Father, for this morning's word. Lord, I just thank you, God, that you have amazing things for us, and you have restoration, and we will not fail to recover all that the enemy has stolen from us. In Jesus' name, amen. So, you're with me in your electronic device or your Bible in 1 Samuel chapter 30. That's where we want to start. This is a really amazing story. David was on the run from King Saul, and these men had gathered to him. 600 men, as a matter of fact, and they picked up families along the way as well. So these 600 men started, because David was a leader, and he had proved himself on the field of battle even before he ran away from King Saul. So all the disgruntled, all of the political enemies of the state, all of the indebted, you know, all of these people gathered themselves, and he became the leader of this rogue group. But by their association with David, they became mighty men, and they became written in the Bible as very mighty people, very mighty men. And their loyalty to David was amazing. But in 1 Samuel chapter 30, it happened when David and his men came to Ziklag on the third day that the Amalekites had invaded the south and Ziklag, and attacked Ziklag and burned it with fire. This was a little town that him and his men lived in Ziklag. And they had taken captive the women and those who were there, from small to great. They did not kill anyone, but carried them away and went their way. So David and his men came to the city, and there it was, burned with fire. And their wives, their sons, and their daughters had been taken captive. Then David and the people who were with him lifted up their voices and wept until they had no more power to weep. And David's two wives, Ahinoam the Jezreelitess, and Abigail, the widow of Nabal the Carmelite, had been taken captive. Now David was greatly distressed, for the people spoke of stoning him, because the soul of all the people was grieved, every man for his sons and daughters. But David strengthened himself in the Lord his God. So this is an interesting story. It really reveals some things about the character of David, right? And what separates the men from the boys and different things. Because tragedy and things, unexpected things happen to people, right?
Yeah.
But some people just seem to just stay in the mourning. They stay in the weeping and in the bitterness of soul. While other people strengthen themselves in the Lord in that situation. Yeah. Easier said than done, right? But some people, rather than, I mean, after a while, you're in this situation, and after you're all done weeping about it, what's left? You have to move forward.
Yeah, right.
You have to seek yeah. God and climb out of this situation. You just can't stay there.
Right.
Right. Right. And so, the Amalekites. So David and his men had been attacking the Amalekites and stealing from them for quite a while and harassing them. There wasn't supposed to be any Amalekites.
Right.
If King Saul was obedient to the Lord, these Amalekites wouldn't even have been around. But yet here they were. Right? So the first thing that happens when tragedy hits is we want to know whose fault this is. Whose fault is this? And so then usually husbands and wives look to each other and they try to blame each other for a while. And then you figure out, you know, this isn't very constructive. This isn't very good for us going forward. I mean, we still have to deal with the problem, even if it was your fault or my fault or both of our faults, right? And in this case, they said, I bet it's David's fault. David is the one who led us to this city and did all this, so it must be his fault because we thought he was the perfect leader who heard from God, you know? And but there was nobody to blame. It's just one of those things that happened.
Yeah.
Right? Okay, there's strength in the Lord for those of you that know Jesus. And I want to look at a couple Bible verses. Psalm 138:3, some of my favorite ones. Psalm 138:3. In the day when I cried out, you answered me and made me bold with strength in my soul. Isn't that good? When you cry out, he's able to make you bold with strength in your soul. See, as a Christian, we realize that we need the Lord. We need his help. We have no problem realizing that. Right? It's not a weakness. It's a strength. To have your faith to rely on and something to rely on. He answered me with strength in my soul. I love that. It's one of my favorite ones. Psalm 27:1. I quote this one a lot because it's very important to declare what the Bible says.
Yeah.
Psalm 27:1. The Lord is my light and my salvation. Whom shall I fear? The Lord is the strength of my life. Of whom shall I be afraid? Everybody say that with me. The Lord is the strength of my life.
Of
whom shall I be afraid? So good, isn't it?
Yes.
Of whom shall you be afraid? The Lord is the strength of my life. The Lord is the strength of my life. Of whom shall I be afraid?
Right.
Yeah. I'll tell you, there's been times where people have quoted that verse and literal physical strength has come upon them for the task. That's the power of agreeing with the word and of declaring what God said and saying,
right.
Yeah, okay, God, I receive what your promise says for me. You are the strength of my life. I don't have any strength left, but you, God, are the strength of my life. And God carries you right through. And you look back and you go, how did I even survive? How did I survive that? Because the Lord is the strength of your life. And Jesus talked about this this house built on a rock, or this house built on the sand. And both the house built on the rock and the house built on the sand had rain come against them and the storms of life, right? So just because you built your house on the rock of Jesus doesn't mean that you're not going to have challenges that come your way. But the world is watching. The unbelievers are watching. They watch to see, okay, this person's supposed to have all this faith in God. How are they going to handle this tragedy? And then when they see God pull you through, and when they see you claiming Him as the strength of your life, and you surviving, they say, you know, I think that there's something to this. The reason why unbelievers are drawn to you is not because they look at how awesome you are and how perfect your life is.
That's right.
They don't look at you and go, you know, someday I'm going to be the paragon of virtue just like you. They could care less. What they want to know is, how is this going to help me get through life?
Yeah.
How is faith in Jesus going to help me?
Right?
And it helps. It helps when you have faith in the Lord. When you, I don't know how people do it when, in life. I mean, if I didn't trust the Lord, I think I'd go crazy if I didn't have the Lord to trust in. He is the strength of my life. Okay. And several more, but we'll go to Ephesians 3:16. That He would grant you, according to the riches of His glory, to be strengthened with might through His Spirit in the inner man. So the riches of glory, remember we talked about that phrase, you could take the riches and glory and change it to unlimited supply. Riches and glory is an unlimited supply of strength. Unlimited supply. Right? He supplies all my needs according to His riches and glory, which is His unlimited supply. He doesn't have any limit to the supply. That's why He can supply all of our needs, right? So strength is the same way. Strengthened with might through His Spirit in the inner man. Now, why is it important to have a strong spirit to be strengthened in the inner man? Well, it's my body that needs strength, not my inner man. Well, the body says that a man's spirit will sustain him in his infirmity or is in his weakness. A strong spirit is very valuable because when attacks come,
That's right.
The strength of your spirit, because you've fed on the Word of God.
Yes.
You've been faithful to try to read your Bible. You've been faithful to go to church and to hear good words and to worship the Lord and to get a good foundation. You have a strong spirit. So when these things happen, it doesn't faze you. Not like these men who just wanted to kill somebody. You will end up strengthening yourself in the Lord. You know where your strength comes from.
Yeah.
Okay, so let's move on now. Let me just quote a couple of verses. Psalm 37, 39, and 40. But the salvation of the righteous is from the Lord. He is their strength in time of trouble. The Lord shall help them and deliver them. He shall deliver them from the wicked and save them because they trust in Him. Psalm 46, 1. God is our refuge and strength, a very present help in trouble.
Yeah.
A very present help in trouble. Psalm 50, verse 15. Call upon me in the day of trouble. I will deliver you and you shall glorify me.
Yeah.
That's the important part. Once you get delivered, don't forget to glorify the Lord.
Right.
Yeah. Don't forget to thank Him and glorify Him. And do that at the end of that. Okay. 1 Samuel chapter 30, verse 7. Point number 2. David inquires of the Lord. Then David said to Abiathar the priest, Ahimelech's son, please bring the ephod here to me. And Abiathar brought the ephod to David. My little tongue's twisting right all of a sudden. Abiathar, ephod. Okay, so David inquired of the Lord, saying, shall I pursue this troop? Shall I overtake them? And he, God, answered him and said, pursue, for you shall surely overtake them and without fail recover all.
Yeah.
Wow. Pursue them, and without fail, you'll recover all. Wow. So, does anybody believe the word of the Lord today?
Amen.
You shall not fail to recover all.
Amen.
I don't know if I believe that. That's because it's by faith. Yeah. But there's this two-letter word, I hate it. It's the worst swear word in the world. It's two letters. It's cussing gone mad. If. Oh, I hate that word. There's always an if. That's a lawyer's word right there. If. I knew there was a catch somewhere. Yeah. It hurts when I hear that word. You mean I have to do something? Yes. What do I have to do? The first thing you have to do is believe. The next thing you have to do is shut your mouth. The pie hole in front of your face. Quit speaking negativities. Quit speaking death over it. Quit declaring negative things over it. If God says without fail you'll recover all, you should get a skip in your step. But I don't have it yet. Yeah, but God said. That's, you can bank on what he said. It's impossible for him to lie. Are we reading the same Bible? He said it's impossible for him to lie. Impossible. God is not a man that he should lie, or a son of man that he should repent. Has he not spoken? And shall he not make it good? But somebody has to believe it. Yeah. When people put their faith in the Lord and they follow after Jesus and trust in him, he restores. And what I've seen is the restoration of the Lord is many times, almost every single time, better than what you had before. Okay, that's going to take a little convincing, I understand. But if you have your Bible, turn with me to Job chapter 42, 10 and 12. Remember, it was called the captivity. The Lord turned back the captivity of Job. Remember all the things he suffered, everything he lost, everything. And he had some really good friends that came to him and kept telling him that it was probably because of his hidden sin in his life that all these evil things had come upon him. Everybody needs friends like that to come to their life. And, okay, I know I'm not perfect, and I really don't need you to point out all of the things that have caused me to fail. I remember this girl one time, she was teasing me. I was a youth pastor. She said, "Pastor Al, you're a loser," because we'd tease each other, you know. And she'd say that, and I'd go, and, but for some reason, I was kind of feeling like a loser that day. And so it didn't. You know how sometimes people say something, you feel a little dark going. You go, oh. So she said, "Pastor Al, you're a loser," and I said, "You know, I've set goals to fail, and by God, I've achieved every one." So how could I have failed? It was on purpose. Okay. So anyways, Job chapter 42, verse 10. "And the Lord restored Job's losses when he prayed for his friends. Indeed, the Lord gave Job..." Well, wait a minute. Isn't restoration the same amount that you lost? Apparently, the Lord's restoration, his math is different than ours. Because it says here, God, that the Lord gave Job twice as much as he had before. Twice. Double. Now, there's some things he couldn't get back. His wife left him and his kids were dead, right? But he ended up obviously remarrying. And he ended up having beautiful, his daughters were so beautiful in the land that everyone praised the beauty of his daughters. So there was even though he couldn't get those children back, God restored him with other children. And another wife. Ooh, it's awful quiet, this church today. I won't pick in any other denominations anymore, except the Presbyterians. It's quiet in here, quieter than a Presbyterian church. We love the Presbyterians, I can pick on them. Yeah. Well, it's not some of them I know. Especially on Facebook. Okay, so, anyways, twice as much. Okay, that didn't bless you. And verse 12, and the Lord blessed the latter days of Job more than his beginning. Whoa. Oh, my fruitfulness is over. I'm 30 years old now. It's all over. I was expecting to do this and this by the time I was 30. Now life is done. I'm 30 and it's all over now. I never achieved my dream of being a multi-billionaire. I set the bar high, but hey, you know. Next year. Oh my gosh. Yeah. Well, I'll tell you, some of the most fruitful people in the Bible didn't become fruitful till their latter years. Actually, most millionaires aren't made till after they're 60. The reason's because they failed so many times, they really learn what doesn't work until finally they get to 60. But that person didn't quit, did they? They just kept going and going and going and going. But also in the Bible, you look at the fruitfulness of people in their latter years. The Apostle John didn't write anything till he was in his 90s. And he was the youngest of the disciples. But yet when he became in his 90s, he wrote the Gospel of John, he wrote 1st, 2nd, and 3rd John, and he wrote the book of Revelation. All of that in his 90s. So, it's not too late for you. Is anybody here 90 yet? Headed there, you're almost there. Yeah. Your best years are yet to come. The latter days shall be more than the beginning. Woo! And you know, Abraham was in his, he was 130 years old. He remarried and had a bunch of kids. It's right there in your Bible. Read the book of Genesis. He married another woman, Keturah, and had a bunch of kids. Wow, I think that was there just to show you that there's fruitfulness in your latter years. You'll be fresh and flourishing to declare that the Lord is righteous. There is no unrighteousness in him. Okay, so Isaiah 61. You've gone too far, Pastor. Well, I know. So Isaiah 61, verse 7. Instead of your shame, you feel like, oh man. It's not pride, it's dignity. There's a difference between, you know, false pride that, and then there's self-dignity where you're like, I just feel like my dignity has been just defiled. Well, God says that he'll take away your shame. Thank you, Jesus. Instead of your shame, you shall have double honor. And instead of confusion, they shall rejoice in their portion. Therefore, in their land, they shall possess double. Everlasting joy shall be theirs. Woo! Double. Okay. So every time something fails or I lose something, or something doesn't go the way I planned it, I go, oh, God's got something better. His restoration is always double. Right? Is that just the power of positive thinking? No, that's faith. Because when the eyes of your faith, you see that, okay, God's hand is in this and he's doing something that's going to be better. Yeah. It's going to somehow be better.
Amen. That's right.
Okay. Well, next thing, let's go back to our story. So back in 1 Samuel chapter 30, so God, he spoke to him, he said, pursue, for you shall overtake them and without fail recover all. So David and his 600 men, by faith in what God said, let's go after them, boys.
Come on.
Get the posse. And so David went, he and the 600 men who were with him, and came to the brook Besor, where those stayed were left behind. But David pursued, he and 400 men, for 200 stayed behind, who were so weary that they could not cross the brook Besor. Have you ever grieved and been in a situation where you're just exhausted from the grieving? And you don't know why you're so tired, but you do. I often counsel people when they're going through grief to make sure that they're getting some rest. Because a lot of people get sick during the grieving process because it's very strenuous on your emotions. It's very hard on people sometimes. But besides that, they had marched 3 days' journey before that to get to Ziklag, and then they came to Ziklag and saw this. Now they're on the march immediately afterwards again. So you really can understand why. And these were very physically fit young men. Okay? But then verse 11, and they found an Egyptian in the field and brought him to David, and they gave him bread, and he ate. And they let him drink water. And they gave him a piece of a cake of figs and two clusters of raisins. So when he had eaten, his strength came back to him, and he had eaten no bread, for he had eaten no bread nor drank water for 3 days and three nights. Then David said to him, to whom do you belong, and where are you from? And he said, I am a young man from Egypt, servant of an Amalekite. My master left me behind because 3 days ago I got sick. We made an invasion of the southern area of the Cherethites, which is the Judah, and in the territory which belongs to Judah, and to the southern area of Caleb, we burned Ziklag with fire. And David said to him, can you take me down to this troop? And he said, swear to me by God that you will neither kill me nor deliver me to the hands of my master, and I will take you down to this troop. So you can see how cruel of a taskmaster these Amalekites were, especially this one. I mean, to have a slave and then you know, use him for all he's worth, and then when he's sick, just leave him behind and discard him. But his cruelty was the opposite of David's kindness. And little did the Amalekite know that his very act of cruelty was going to be the undoing of all of them. Because that very act of cruelty left somebody to guide them to where they were. Wow. Yeah. And God was with them. And the cruelty of the Amalekites is undoing. The kindness of David brings guidance. And it's so good. The Bible says even the wicked are cruel to their animals. But the tender mercies of the wicked are even cruel. It says cruel people. Mean. Yeah. Have you ever met any? Yeah. Wow. What's really terrible is mean people think everybody else thinks like them. So they project meanness on everybody else. They think everybody's just as mean, going to be just as mean to them as they are to everybody else. Everybody's just as critical of them as they are of everybody else. So they treat you like they would. They think that they are. That's the way they are. They never assume good motives in anybody because their heart is wicked. Perhaps you've met some. Don't be like them. Okay, so let's go to number four. David recovers all. So, verse 16. So when he had brought him down, there they were, spread out over all the land, eating and drinking and dancing, because all the great spoil which they had taken from the land of the Philistines and from the land of Judah. And David attacked them from twilight until the evening of the next day. Not a man of them escaped, except 400 young men who rode on camels and fled. That's kind of interesting, that the amount of men who fled was the amount of David's army. And David's small army, because they caught him unprepared, and they caught him probably all drunked up, you know. They got him unawares. And it says, so David recovered all that the Amalekites had carried away, and David rescued his two wives. Now this is a verse that needs to be underlined in your Bible. Verse 19, underlined, highlight, little stars by it. And nothing of theirs was lacking, either small or great, sons or daughters, spoil or anything which they had taken from them. David recovered all. God did exactly what he promised that he was going to do. They went forward in faith, and restoration happened. Alright? Yeah, it's such a good testimony. Such a good testimony. I suppose I want to give you a Bible verse. This is 2 Corinthians 1:20. I'll give you one. For the promises of God in him are yes, and in him amen, to the glory of God through us. That is so good. Now look at verse 14 of chapter 2 of 2 Corinthians. 2 Corinthians chapter 2, verse 14. Now thanks be to God who always leads us in triumph in Christ, and through us diffuses the fragrance of his knowledge in every place. Now, I know that I have a degree in all that, a lot of degrees, but I'm just simple. I don't like intellectualizing things to the point where you nullify the power of the simplicity of the Word of God.
Yeah, that's right.
I tend to want to challenge myself to just be very straightforward about, is this what God says? And not read anything, you know, crazy into it. Now, thanks be to God who always leads us in triumph. Whoa. Always. Always leads you in triumph. There's some kind of victory here. We have to follow his lead. Strengthen ourselves in him. Seek him with all your heart. And it's going to work out. He's going to show you what to do. And then you're going to obey. And you're going to move forward in what he tells you to do. And you're going to, without fail, recover all.
Amen.
And then some.
Amen.
And then some. I'm just fool enough to look at it and go, well, always means always, doesn't it? There's some kind of victory to be had. Always. 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 Not this one. This one's so bad. How could you even say that there's any kind of victory to be had in this? It's so tragic. It's so terrible. I'm not minimizing any tragedy. I'm not minimizing any terrible, evil thing that the devil has accomplished and gotten away with. Right? But somehow, even this evil world where all these terrible things happen, God can lead us into some kind of triumph for those who trust him.
Amen.
Faith. Wow. Living by faith. Trust in the Lord with all your heart and lean not on your own understanding. In all your ways, acknowledge him and... Right. You know, the highest form of faith is when you don't understand. The highest form of faith that you can possibly have is a blind faith. It's when you're trying to look for answers and there are no answers to this. This side of heaven. And you still have to trust. Woo! There was no explanation. I mean, God never gave David an explanation. Well, David, let me give you an explanation of why I allowed the Amalekites to come and burn your little town down. He never got that. Never got any of that. All he got was, pursue, and you shall not fail to recover all. That's all he got out of the deal. Well, I'm mad because God didn't give me an answer. He didn't tell me and explain to me why. Unfortunately, it might be beyond our comprehension.
Yeah. Come on.
It might be way beyond our pay grade. Yeah. And then you have to fall back on, well, I know that God's loving and he's kind and he's merciful and he's good. And the devil's a mean devil, and God's a good God. Yeah? Okay. So, last point here. Let's go back to our story. I want to make one last point. And so after they recovered all, let's remember now, not only did they have all of David's stuff, the Amalekites, but Ziklag was on the tail end of their raiding spree. They had already went through and grabbed a bunch of stuff from the Philistines, and they grabbed a bunch of stuff from the other part of Judah and everything. So they had more stuff than David's and his army stuff. They had all kinds of stuff. So when they defeated them and drove away, they took everything. The restoration was way beyond what they recovered. They not only recovered all, but they recovered all this other stuff too. So it says here, and then of course some of the guys wanted the 200 that stayed behind to not share in the spoils of the victory. But this is a very important lesson that David said to the men. He said, "What makes you think that it was all on us, that it was all us that did the victory?
Come on,
God is the one who gave us the victory. Well, I was the one swinging the sword, but who gave you the strength to swing that sword? Who even gave you the direction to go after them in the first place? Who helped you? How could your little band of men defeat a great army? And the 400 of them, equal number to the men you had, ran off. And you still had a miraculous victory." So when we think that we did it all ourselves, then we're selfish and greedy, right? But when we remember that the Lord, it was the Lord's hand that helped us, actually everything I have, I'm just the steward of. God has blessed me. Everything I have is not even mine. I'm just the steward of it. If God tells me to do this or that with it, I'm going to do that with it. I'm the steward, but I don't own anything, really. I don't even own my kids. I'm just steward of my kids when they're growing up. Right? They're God's. Everything's God's. I'm just trying to be faithful being the steward of what's His. This church isn't mine. Of course not. This is God's church. I didn't purchase this church with my blood. He purchased you with His blood. We're just the stewards of this thing. Yeah. Who gives the victory? The Lord. So why should we not share and share alike to everybody? And then David did more than that. Let's go down to verse 26. "Now when David came to Ziklag, he sent some of the spoil to the elders of Judah, to his friends, saying, 'Here is a present for you from the spoil of the enemies of the Lord.' To those who were in Bethel, those who were in Ramoth to the south, those who were in Jatar," and then it goes on to explain several other cities. And then in the last verse, "those who were in Hebron and all the places where David himself and his men were accustomed to rove." So David had been roving, and those people had been very generous to him. So now that he had this huge victory, he was generous back. And after his great generosity, in the next chapter, King Saul gets killed. In contrast to David's great victory, King Saul has a great defeat against the Philistines, and he's killed. And those cities that David now has great favor with, because he gave the spoils of the victory, they wanted him to become their king and to now come and take care of them, be their leader. So the victory ended up working for him. It worked for him. Nothing works against you, but all things work for you. Wow. Except for that pesky word, if. If. Oh, great. If I believe, if I trust, if I obey, yeah, all that kind of stuff. You have to keep on being consistent in these things. You have to keep on seeking God, keeping your heart right, keeping your heart pure of all malice and ill will and bitterness and hatred and overcriticalness and meanness, you know? Yeah. I'll tell you, there's nothing worse. There's a difference. There's sometimes a Christian who can not drink, not smoke, not chew, not go with girls who do. They can have it outside all perfect and look all good, but inside they're meaner than a junkyard dog.
Yeah.
And they're angry and they're bitter. Yeah. What happened to them? gosh. Yeah. I mean, here they are, you know, all nasty on the inside, and they're not even having any fun on the outside either. I mean, if you're going to sin, you might as well. No, just kidding. I mean, if you're going to go to hell, bust hell wide open, let's make a party out of this deal. Yeah. Okay, I'm crass, I know. Let's bow our heads this morning. We're gonna examine our hearts. Get rid of the meanness. Get rid of it now. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. We trusted you. You were able to restore. We are not bitter against you, God. We know that we trust you and that you can make all things work together for good for those who love you and who are called according to your purpose. We know that you can turn it around, that you can bring us into the promised land. You can bring us into the new things. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life. Thank you, Lord, that you have a plan that we cannot see. We trust you, Lord Jesus. We trust you, Lord Jesus. We trust you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord. I was getting a picture in my mind of a watch with all the cogs going around and the timing of the intricacy of it, and then of the changes of season and the intricacy of the moving of the planets, and the universe is like God's stopwatch. It's God's clock, God's amazing clock, and God has timing. He has perfect timing, and his timing is not necessarily our timing, but he knows the best timing. Our times are in his hands, it says. So we have him on our time, and he says, that's not my time for you. This is my time. So we have to wait on him and trust him and continue to be obedient, continue to keep our hearts clear, and his timing is perfect. Thank you, Jesus. Tell you another thing too is you cannot control what other people do. You can only control your response to that. Right? I mean, people do stuff. I mean, and you just have to. You can't control them, but you can decide that you're going to not be bitter, that you're going to trust the Lord, that you're going to love Him, that you're going to go forward in Him, and He's got something good, really good. Yeah. It would almost be a shame to when that person sees you happy all the time. What are you so happy about? I thought I really hurt you bad. Well, God's got something better than you, bub. Oh, yeah. Okay, thank you, Jesus. He does, though. That's the truth of it. Yeah. Even if you've made some mistakes. Isn't it true that if we confess our faults to Him, He's faithful and just to forgive us and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness?
Yeah.
Isn't that what it says?
Yeah, right.
So we get right, and it's just as if we haven't sinned.
Right.
And He's able to restore.
Yeah.
When we own up to it. Okay, thank you, Jesus. I don't know where I'm taking us. I'm waiting on the Lord. God's got something, I know, but let's just wait on the Lord for just a minute. Let's stand up if you would. Is there anybody here that's ever lost anything? Anybody? 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 Okay, thank you, Jesus, for honest people. I've never lost, Pastor. I've won at everything. Even at the game Settlers of Catan. Yeah. So, listen to me now. You have to do a step of faith now. If you want restoration from the Lord, I want you to gather up here, right around here in the front. I know it's a very small area, but just if you want restoration, take a step of faith. Say, yes,
Amen.
God has restoration for me in some areas.
That's right.
God has restoration for me. He's able to make it good, what I feel like I've lost. He's able to make it good. He's got something better. He's got some. Come on up. There's a lot of people behind you. Come on up forward. Yeah. Come on up. Why would you not want restoration? No, I don't want restoration. Yes, you do. Everyone should want restoration. Okay, lift up your hands to the Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Now repeat after me. I will pursue. And I will without fail. Recover all. I will pursue. And I will without fail. Recover all. Thank you for your restoration, God. Thank you for your victory, Lord God. Thank you for the good things to come. I'm looking for the good, not for the bad. Goodness and mercy will follow me all the days of my life. Say it. Goodness and mercy will follow me all the days of my life. Yes, yes, yes. God has good things, good things, good things. You know, it's when they sang, what was that phrase they sang when the glory cloud came, honey? For his goodness. For he is good, and his mercy endures forever. That's what they sang. They sang that over and over. Yeah. And then the glory came. The glory came. Yeah. The glory came. The glory came. Yeah. I'll tell you, mercy exalts itself over judgment. We know that mercy is the most important thing in God's. He took all of his wrath out on Jesus on the cross. So that he could show you and me mercy to those who put their faith in him. Mercy triumphed over judgment. Thank you, Jesus. He's not trying to get you. He's trying to help you.
Yeah.
He's trying to help you.
Yeah, come on.
Thank you, God. His goodness is... Well, how's that phrase go, honey? His goodness, mercy endures forever. She's better than me at this kind of stuff.
Mercy endures forever.
Yes. She remembers everything. Yeah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Okay, but I guess we should pray and close, huh? Thank you, Jesus, for this morning. You're so good. You're so good to us. Thank you for your mercy and your loving kindness. If there's anybody that doesn't know Jesus today and you want to put your trust in him, I want you to repeat this prayer after me. Dear Lord Jesus, I ask you to forgive me of my sins. Please come into my heart and into my life. Make me new. I put my trust in you today. Today I'm a new creation in Christ Jesus. All things have become new. Amen. Amen. If you said that prayer for the first time, we have a free booklet in the back. Also, I want you to tell me about it, or tell you got to tell somebody about it, because that seals the deal in the spirit. When you confess your salvation to somebody else, something happens and it seals the deal, and a miracle will happen in your heart. So you have to tell somebody. It's very important. And thank you, Lord, for this beautiful church, this wonderful church. Lord, I thank you, God. I just pray, Lord, that you would bless our going out and our coming in. And bless our small groups tonight and everything that transpires, and let your glory go with us. And I thank you that you are able to cause our faces to radiate with your love and your beauty. In Jesus' name, amen. God bless you.